Skeptics, are you sick of debunking miracle claim after miracle claim? What if there was one video you could send Christians that would disabuse them of their miracle beliefs forever? Well, I have the video for you. Rationality Rules has destroyed the argument from miracles forever. Checkmate, Christians. End of story. Bye-bye. See you later. In all seriousness, though, Stephen Woodford, aka Rationality Rules, believes he's debunked the argument for miracles. And since this video has been viewed just a few times, I'd like to offer my two cents. For starters, Woodford says the argument for miracles fails to support theism of any kind of stripe. Here's Stephen.
So the first flaw to reveal, in my not-so-humble opinion, is that the vast majority of miracles wouldn't prove the existence of God, even if they were indeed true. Or in other words, they don't support theism. For example, even if it were unimpeachably true that a man called Jesus resurrected, this would not, in the slightest, prove that the universe had a creator. Nor would it prove that Jesus turned water into wine, that he healed the blind, that he walked on water, or that he was born of a virgin. All it would prove is that a man called Jesus respawned, and that he had terrible lag because it took him 3 days.
Oof. I appreciate the solid video game joke and all, but where do we begin? Let's keep this really simple. That the resurrection is positively relevant to theism on ordinary background evidence should be obvious. Simply and somewhat loosely put, the probability that God exists is higher if there is evidence that Jesus rose from the dead than if there was no such evidence. And this is true because the probability that the resurrection took place is roughly zilch if there is no God, and a lot higher if there is. On any plausible background assumptions, if Jesus of Nazareth died and physically rose 3 days later, theism's probability of being correct is roughly equal to 1. Think about it for just a second. Why do atheist biblical scholars like Gerd Ludemann or Michael Golder or other atheist YouTubers work so hard to debunk the evidence for the resurrection? In part, precisely because they understand that it has serious implications for theism. To say that a miracle like the resurrection has no theistic implications whatsoever is frankly just absurd. But Stephen's definitely not done yet, so let's give him another shot. Here's the second argument.
With this acknowledged, the second and perhaps most obvious flaw with miracles is that they either commit an argument from ignorance or a personal incredulity fallacy. To illustrate this, consider the following. Throughout history, there have been numerous accounts of flightless animals raining from the sky. And needless to say, on just about every occasion, someone somewhere has asserted that a miracle has occurred. Because there's no other explanation. Now, of course, it's fair to say that flightless animals don't just fall from the sky. But one can't simply assert that a miracle has occurred simply because there's no other explanation. That would be, and is, an outrageous argument from ignorance. It is, in essence, we don't know, therefore God. Anyhow, as it turns out, we now actually do have an adequate explanation. Which, by the way, perfectly demonstrates why arguments from ignorance are flawed. This explanation is, quite simply, a tornado that's formed over a body of water, otherwise known as a waterspout, that's then hurled water and aquatic animals over land. It's a bizarre phenomenon, incredible even, but it's not a miracle because it doesn't violate the laws of nature. Yet, despite the fact that we now know exactly how flightless animals can rain from the sky, many people still assert that the only explanation is divine intervention, because they either don't personally know about waterspouts, or they don't understand them, which, as you may or may not know, isn't an argument from ignorance, but rather, it's a personal incredulity fallacy.
Rationality Rules is right about this. Nature does definitely do some weird stuff sometimes. And we're obviously not justified in crediting miracles to everything that we currently don't understand. But when it comes to the resurrection or the virgin birth, is there ever going to be a time where scientists discover a law that tells us that dead people don't stay dead or that virgins can get pregnant? Given our current scientific understanding, I would say the likelihood of that is virtually nil. While some personal incredulity is definitely not justified, like why flightless animals can rain from the sky at times, some things just stubbornly resist our current scientific framework. This has caused us to revise our framework when we need to. But why can't there be a case that's just so obstinate that it would resist scientific explanation altogether? If Woodford wants to say that this can't possibly happen, then that would just be an extreme example of begging the question for naturalism. So that's strike two for Woodford, but let's give him another shot.
And this brings us comfortably to a necessary question that is extremely effective at exposing a third fallacy that ravishes miraculous assertions. This question is, how exactly can we distinguish a miracle from an unlikely natural occurrence that we are yet to comprehend? It's a very simple question, but it's a brilliant one, if I do say so myself, because it forces the proponent to bear their burden of proof, rather than allowing them to shift it to you by appealing to ignorance. And if they can't, and instead they either attempt to shift the burden of proof to you, or they simply appeal to ignorance, then guess what? Their assertion is unsubstantiated, and therefore their argument is too. Meaning that it's game over. No ifs, no buts, it's over.
Stephen's rejection of supernatural explanations isn't based on the existence of an alternate explanation in terms of natural causes, but on the hope one will come in the future. That is just one heck of a promissory note. I don't think he'd like to admit it, but Woodford sounds like a bit of an enemy of science here. Our increased knowledge of conception and physiology has made events like the virgin birth and the resurrection harder, not easier, to explain using natural causes. He's put himself in a position of being skeptical of our current state of scientific knowledge that tells us that virgins don't get pregnant and dead people stay dead. And the argument for miracles isn't just about plugging God into gaps in our own understanding. It just depends on the sort of evidence that we have. So for example, if I were to come home and my back door was kicked in, my house was trashed, and my TV and my laptop were missing, I'd call the cops. If the police came and said, "You only believe in a thief because you haven't yet discovered a naturalistic explanation for the disappearance of your expensive electronics," I'd be like, "Are there hidden cameras somewhere? Am I being punked? I mean, where's Ashton?" Some things are clearly caused by agents and not impersonal natural causes. And if God wanted to get a message across, a resurrection from the dead is definitely one way to get our attention. We can't just shrug our shoulders and say, "Oh, I don't know, but maybe future humans will figure that out one day and they'll prove that it definitely happened naturalistically." That is just the blind faith of a naturalist. Alright, so that's strike three for Stephen, but he does have one final argument. Rationality Rules talks about miracle claims being based on personal anecdotes and appeals to emotion. He brings up sketchy faith healers, and I respect where he's coming from. In the video that he shows, there's a clip of something shady going on during a church meeting. In the description down below, you can watch Rationality Rules video in its entirety, but here's Woodford's main point.
Now, the point of me showing you this clip is to predominantly point out two additional fallacies that are rampant in miraculous claims. The first is the appeal to emotion fallacy, which occurs when Pastor Shaw manipulates both the recipients and the crowd's emotions by shouting and invoking their deeply held beliefs. And the second is the anecdotal fallacy, which occurs after the show when a crowd member asserts that they witnessed a miracle, when they didn't.
Here's the thing. The existence of counterfeit miracles doesn't dismiss us from looking at miracle claims on a case-by-case basis. So for example, when Philostratus tells me that Apollonius of Tyana performed miracles, I can definitely find some rational reasons to be skeptical. Philostratus wrote Apollonius' biography 100 years after his death. It's obviously a big gap of time. His miracles allegedly happened in Rome, Spain, North Africa, India, and Mesopotamia. Philostratus was writing in Greece. That's also a great gap of distance. Or say, like Stephen points out, a zealous believer claims to be healed of some minor ailment in a revival meeting without a doctor present. Something may have happened, but it definitely can be reasonably doubted. They already have that background belief that God heals and are inclined to believe, even if they imagine they feel just a little bit better. But not all miracle claims are this weak. Consider the miracles of Jesus. They're part of the earliest tradition and were even attested by his enemies. Skeptical New Testament scholar Marcus Borg writes, "It is sufficient for the historian to know that Jesus performed deeds that many people, both friends and foes, probably Jesus himself, considered miracles. Christianity started in Jerusalem, where their leader was crucified. Jesus' teachings didn't exactly fit into popular Jewish prejudices, and his earliest followers were accused of preaching against the temple and changing Moses' laws, and they were greatly persecuted. Also, the disciples' enemies' best debunking attempt was to say they stole Jesus' body. Some miracle claims are just a whole lot better attested than others. For reasons like these, Jeff Lauder, one of the founders of infidels.org, honestly admits, I remember thinking to myself that if I took the time to investigate the resurrection, I could make anyone who believed it look like a fool. Or so I thought. I was about to discard it as another illogical religious belief, yet I found it extremely difficult to deal with as a critic. So, no. Woodford has not debunked the argument for miracles. At best, he's given us a reason to doubt some miracle claims, perhaps even many of them. But he definitely has not given us any rational reasons to reject miracles altogether.